Hi everyone, welcome to a fresh new episode of HR Katha presents Happiness at Work, powered by happiness.me. Happiness at Work is a video knowledge series where we discuss different facets of employee happiness, or as the name says, happiness at workplace. Today, we have Anil Gaur as our guest, and
Hi. We
will have a thoughtful discussion on what happiness means for people in manufacturing. Anil is a well-known HR professional and currently the Group Chief People Officer at Uniparts. He carries a bag full of experiences. In his career span of 30 years, he has worked across sectors, engineering, FMCG, life science, chemicals, pharmaceuticals, and automotive. And in terms of companies, he has worked in Dabur, Otis, Nikko Batteries, Tata Power, Maruti Suzuki, Modi Tires, Aisha Tractors, and now Uniparts. Anil, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Prajal.
You know, how do you define happiness? What does happiness mean to you, you know, personally, professionally?
Okay. Happiness... People, they understand happiness in a different manner. So some people will talk about this, you know, this absence of fear, or it's a state of mind, or happiness is an emotion. And I've seen that some people at times, they get confused between happiness and satisfaction. But I believe happiness for an individual, happiness is enjoying every moment. You know, it's a moment which gives you not only the satisfaction, but you know, a sense of fulfillment, a sense of accomplishment. Accomplishment, to my mind, does not mean achieving something big in life. You know, something very small, very tiny, that happens to your life. It brings happiness. I would also say that, you know, getting into the romance. So people, again, they get confused, because generally I made this statement in many forums whenever I talk on any subject. To my mind, romance is something newness in your life. Anything new that happens to you brings happiness, smile on your face, and you get into the romance. I'll give you some classical example. You buy a new pen, or maybe, you know, these days youngsters, they buy every 6 months or 1 year new mobile phone. So the new mobile phone, you're so passionate about it, you're so caring about it, that you will take care of it, you will ensure that it does not get any scratch on the screen. You will be always careful, even the charging pattern, that, you know, it should not be overcharged, the battery should not, you know, get damaged, blah, blah, blah. Same is the case, you know, if you buy a new shirt for yourself, or some new baby comes in the family. Anything which happens new to your life brings a smile on your face, and that, you know, is a kind of a happiness. But when I look at the happiness for people in organization, especially whether it's a manufacturing organization or service industry or any other sector, my definition or my understanding of happiness is warm employee experience. Okay. It's a moment of joy. Any small thing that can give a feeling of wow is a happiness to me.
So, you know, generally I keep speaking to several people, you know, I do a series of interviews around happiness. So some people say, you know, happiness is a science. Some people say happiness is a state of mind. Some people say, you know, that happiness lies, you know, in the moment of doing things. Some people also link it to strategy, saying that, you know, happiness is a strategy, you know, and with the business goal. What, according to you, you know, how would you define happiness? You know, is there a different way you will link it? You could, you know, it, happiness could be different when it comes to your personal life, happiness could be different when it comes to your professional life. And, you know, as an head of people of an organization, your job or, you know, your job entails to, you know, to keep people happy. You know, that's part of your job.
Yeah.
It's
a very rightfully you have asked. To my mind, happiness at personal life and professional life does not make much difference. You know, I'll give you one classical example again.
Yeah.
If suppose you are hungry, and if I give you a promise or assurance that I will take you for fine dining at some certain restaurant after you complete this assignment, right? I don't think that it will bring happiness and a smile on your face. But if I feed you with whatever I have that time, because you're feeling hungry and you need to satisfy your hunger, that will be a moment which will bring happiness on the face of people. So in the organization, wherever I work, it's my, not only because of my profession, but also maybe part of my persona, that I start greeting people right from the security gate. A security guard, I think outsourced guy,
yeah,
for whom interacting or meeting a senior leader may be a dream. But I believe that person do a most important work for me, and I must touch his heart by a very small gesture of greeting him. And I don't wait for that guy to greet me first, right? So ego and all those position, power, everything, let's keep aside. Same is the case with the guys who are housekeeping boys, or maybe pantry boy, or the small young team members. So how we can bring a smile on their faces, maybe by greeting, maybe by, you know, sharing some moment of joy. Maybe if somebody is looking for meeting you, and people have seen that they have a fear factor, because though we talk about the transparent culture, very open work environment in many organizations, but it does not happen. I have seen many organizations.
The reality is
there is a glass ceiling always. So I think in last about 3 years, there are very few moments when I have closed the door of my cabin. Even right now, I have closed it because I don't want anyone to get disturbed me during this interview. But it is always open. Any young guy, even if I'm busy, unless I'm busy with the chairman in some call and all, everyone is welcome any point of time. So I think that brings more happiness and feeling of satisfaction and joy in the people. So to my mind, small activities, small gestures, and creating touch points is more important to bring happiness at work. So when I talk about wow employee experience, so the wow employee experience does not mean that it is limiting to the people who work for me. Wow experience starts from a candidate or incumbent who have shown interest to join Unipart for a certain role. So that the experience start there. The how my recruiter deals with the incumbent. How, what kind of a treatment and behavior, or through the communication, that person demonstrate to a recruiter. Small examples again. Any person who has been shortlisted or selected,
Okay. Whether
we have issued the offer or we have not issued the offer, but I'm interested in that guy, that he must come on board. Birthday, self-birthday, spouse birthday, children's birthday, because we have got all the personal information.
Yeah.
Wedding anniversary, we try to greet them. And we don't know whether this guy will join or not. That is a later event. But that is the happiness we try to bring in, right? And if we get to know that the employee has a, or the incumbent rather, not employee, he has an elderly parent. So we try to even interact with them. Idea behind it, that showcasing that we are the company who care for the people.
The warmth.
Right. So, right. Okay. So, for example, In one of the senior leaders' role, when we were about to close the offer, we got to know the guy said that no, he may not be able to do it because of few reasons, purely personal. And I spoke to his parents, and I greeted them as if you know I'm their son or a very close friend to the son, and I said, "Don't worry, we will take care of this." We try to give him comfort, and then subsequently, the counter pressure started building from the parents and the wife on this guy that you must join this company. And I used to work those days. I used to work in some other business, and the chairman, he called me. He said, "Hey, you did wonder because chairman wanted that guy to come on board." Right. So when that was converted, when it was got converted in yes,
yes,
it brought happiness to the incumbent, to the family, and chairman, and of course me. Right.
Tell me something. You know, generally today, if you see, India is divided into two parts. I say, you know, if you see, one is a very upmarket urban India, where you have got white collar employees working. Their mindset, their you know, sense of achievement, their ambitions in life is very different. You know, so which we probably see, you know, in a Bangalore, in a Pune, or, you know, the IT or the MNC work culture that they follow. You know, on the other end of the spectrum, you have sectors like manufacturing, where you have people working at the grassroots level, where, you know, they are much more, they have to face the reality of the situation. For them, aspirations are very different. How, you know, if I talk in terms of happiness, how do you divide the, or how do you differentiate the two worlds, or what does happiness mean for people at the grassroots level, somebody who is walking at the shop floor, you know, trying to meet his daily needs? Obviously, you know, we can't have the same contours or same question of happiness for both or the two ends of the spectrum.
I think that happiness quotient for white collar or blue collar or urban or rural people is the same, right? Stimuli may differ.
Okay.
What stimulates you to be happy and not to be happy, that can differentiate. For example, a senior person who's earning a good, handsome salary, the guy may be happy by buying a luxury car. Right, but for a shop floor worker, buying a dress for his school-going child who has been aspiring to get a dress, maybe at the time of Diwali or Eid, that is the more that brings the happiness. So the, you know, that the gravity could be different, but the quotient remains the same. And coming from the manufacturing background, throughout my career, I've been working in manufacturing. I believe the happiness quotient for both the population, both set of people is the same. And we have tried not to differentiate between the two. It should not be prerogative only for the white collar people or, you know, so-called people wearing tie and sitting in air conditioning offices. Let me also explain this in a different perspective. I believe that in any organization, especially in manufacturing, if I'm talking about, there are only two people who are highly engaged in Indian context.
Yeah.
It's a promoter who has put in his heart, soul, and capital to build the organization, and the worker. It is the worker in India, barring few examples, you will not fight attrition in workmen population. They will join and they will happily retire from the same organization. But the people like so-called professional like me,
yeah,
you have named, you know, so many companies I've worked for, we are not loyal. We are not loyal to the organization, right? And we claim ourselves as a professional. So that means we are not engaged. We are engaged temporarily. Start period, and there is an end period also.
So we are engaged till the time our interests are met.
Right. There are many reasons. There could be many reasons for that, right? But this guy is engaged in totality. Right? Therefore, their happiness is also, utmost important for us. It should be. Now, what we do, okay, live examples. So when this, in COVID period, everybody started talking and there was a flood of webinar and people had different kind of subjects they have started. So instead of, talking good things, we looked at what kind of a baby steps we can take to bring happiness on the face of people. So first decision that nobody, in spite of whether business goes up or down last year, in March 2019, whatever happens to the business, nobody will lose the job. That was the first cardinal principle. And I spoke to my chairman and he was so kind to accept this request or proposal. And he said, Kyanil, yes, I agree with you and let us stick to that. So that was one. Prior to that, before the government of India could decide, although Unipart is not a big business, although I work with many OEMs, a large-scale organization, but it's a relatively smaller business. In spite of that, we decided that we will not follow government or neighboring industry that what they are doing. We will create our own benchmark. And that is my philosophy. Wherever I work, I believe that I should not follow. I should not look at the benchmarking others. Rather, I should create my benchmark. So much before the government of India notified the lockdown, we started work from home, right? Number one. Number two, second decision was nobody will lose the job, right? Although there was certain decision, unpleasant decision also we have taken of salary cut and, no increment. But when the business has came back on the track and we looked at the business results somewhere in mid of last financial year, I decided, and it won't took 15 minutes with the board to take a decision to roll back all the salary cut decision. So before Diwali, and I put my foot down, and I won't say that I should claim the credit, but yes, it was the support of the board and the chairman, and they have approved it, and that was the again happy moment for the people. Similarly, extending the support. If somebody is ill, government said that 14 days leave, but we said, okay, whatever period, if the guy is ill, we will not deduct the salary, the guy will get the salary. We started reimbursement of RT-PCR test, because reason is that guy who's earning 30,000 rupees for him, spending 1,000 or 1,500 rupees for RT-PCR test is a big money, yeah. Small moment, So that reimbursement or arranging free of cost RT-PCR test or arranging, providing the meal, the contract labor in our manufacturing facility, we offered them, okay, that everyone, nobody need to worry on the food. So we provided the meal to them, apart from their salary or the compensation, or whatever we have been paying them, taking care of the family wherever possible, taking care of the children wherever possible, right? And even in the second wave, we have also introduced the policies of benevolent fund support and some kind of a support system to the family in case somebody has lost their life during the COVID. So those small gestures, whatever comes our way, we took very fast decision. And more importantly, empowering people has also brought happiness. People at the different remote locations, small guys, even somebody with 5-10 years of experience, is guys managing 2-3 people, a team. Let him decide whatever, if someone wants to allow work from home to some employee. I think this whole, the entire bundle of the thought process or small things, it has brought a high level of happiness and it has brought in a result of engagement quotient.
So empowering people because I believe they are, at the local level, they are the closest ones to the people out there, the supervisor or the manager who is there at the local level. And he knows exactly what, the other person or his team wants or would need.
another point I would like to add here, which
your voice is strongly,
I want to add one more point which I strongly believe is a capability of organization for tolerance to mistakes. So I have created a culture here where mistakes are welcomed, right? Somebody at a lower level, if a guy has a good intent, so I call it 3I principle. You know, it's a intent, interest, and initiative. So that if you have a good intent, so what we generally talk to the people, if somebody believe that whatever he or she wants to do is good for the organization, good for the business at a local level, and good for the people, go ahead. In the process, if there is a mistake, if suppose decision is comes to a wrong decision, because I still believe that there is no right or wrong decision in business. Any decision which brings or serves my purpose or brings some value to me is the right decision for me, right? So that kind of a culture we are trying to create. I'm not saying that we have achieved everything in this direction, but this is a journey. And we are moving into the direction of creating a very open, transparent, and happy and healthy work environment.
So happiness, you're saying happiness depends on trust. Happiness in an organization depends on trust. Happiness in an organization depends on, you know, how we show that, how we care. Tell me something, you know, happiness, people link happiness to business goals. You know, people say that, you know, happiness has to be a business strategy. It has to be linked to productivity. Do you think happiness can be so transactional?
Not directly, but yes, it can give you tangible results, right? If I curse my son, for not studying and not preparing for his exams, it will lead to only disturbance in the family, right? And it won't get me the desired results which I'm looking for, right? On the other hand, if I spend some time in education, training, and guiding, supporting, and handholding, and allow him to enjoy in his own space, I should also minimize my interference in his space, right? But review, monitoring, and keeping a watch is important. You know, those processes must continue in a business situation, right? I think sooner or later, the results will come. Result is an outcome, right? You cannot determine result and then guide people on a dotted line that, okay, you have to do this to achieve this. Give them the target, believe in their confidence, believe in their capability, believe in their determination, because you have hired them. No, these people didn't come. I hired them, right? And when I hire a person, I believe that I'm hiring the right person for me.
Yeah.
But yes, there would be certain gaps. And it is my responsibility to plug in those gaps by training, retraining, skilling, upskilling, and organizing a kind of an onboarding process which is best suited to me. And once that has happened, that I must have a confidence in their capability. So I think that will bring the results. But yes, business is business. Business is ruthless.
Yeah.
And business has no face, and business has no emotions also. So all happiness and all those things are important, this, you know, so-called intangibles. But I also believe the days have gone when we used to talk tangible in HR or tangible in the people strategy. In people strategy, you have to lay focus on intangibles, but those intangibles will get you the tangible results. That is, I'm confident. Things will not happen overnight. It's the human life or human behavior is not, very quick and short. And in life, I don't think the quick fixes or shortcuts will get you the sustainable business growth or business achievement. So you have to have patience. And that is another area which we try to educate, guide, support our people in Uniparts also. For example, the millennials, our young population, they are highly energetic, well-informed, passionate, wants to achieve miracles overnight. And they're highly influenced by two-minute noodle culture, instant money, right? And they believe that the moment they will pass out from college, they will get a job with handsome salary, and they will buy either, you know, a nice bike or a four-wheeler, couple of years, then dating, and then marriage, and house, blah, blah, blah. You know, there's a long...
Much more planned, you know.
So what we educate them, and this is equally important for the shop floor worker as well, because they're also millennial, you know.
Yeah.
What we educate them, that life is not a two-minute noodle. Life does not get you results overnight. So you have to have patience also. So it does not go the way that you insert the ATM card in the machine and you get the money. It won't happen. You know? So you have to step in, take initiative, learn out through this process, and then grow gradually, right? So building the capability, focusing on the skill upliftment is the key. And in the process, when small things which I talked about, if you take care of all these things, or personal care and touch for the people, so the touch point which I was referring that before joining, touch point when a person comes on board, and then throughout the journey, that is important. Right? And still, I again reiterate my statement that taking baby steps, taking small areas into consideration, gives you better happiness quotient, better engaged employee, rather than thinking something big.
Okay. Tell me something, you know, would you, you know, do you think happiness or, you know, is linked to professional success, and how much of it depends on that?
I don't know whether it can be linked to the professional success, but I'm sure that it is directly linked to the personal success. Success or personal accomplishment. And when you are happy, you are satisfied, and you have a sense of accomplishment in your personal life, it also impacts positively in your professional life. Right? When I started my career, my seniors and, you know, some faculty member, they used to teach us that personal life and professional life are two different things. But I don't believe. I never believed on this. And I still had a very strong belief that these are interlinked and interdependent. Right? So there is a small story. Probably most of the people might have read it in the WhatsApp, because that is the biggest and most effective communication channel now. So the story goes like this, that there was a one fine day, there was a guy getting ready for the office, and so he got ready, came to the breakfast table, and every day he used to drop the young daughter to the school while going to the office. So this girl was playing as a small child, and her hand, you know, touched the coffee cup. Coffee fell on this guy's clothes, and in the return, you know, out of aggression, he slapped the child, and the child started crying badly. The wife got annoyed that how come, you know, he has slapped the child. So this guy went to the bedroom again to change the clothes, came back. The child was annoyed. She refused to go to the go along with the father to the school, but somehow, you know, the mother console, and then she came. She didn't talk to the father during the travel. She didn't say goodbye when she got off to the school. Now this guy again, okay, Raj, he was getting late, so he was trying to be faster, crossed the traffic signal, police cop caught him, when they didn't listen to any of the argument and gave him the slip of the challan, he tried to pull out the wallet and then realized the wallet was left in the other trouser which he was wearing. Right? So the cops has seized his vehicle. Again, he could manage to hire a cab, then requested somebody in the office to pay the money for the cab, reached office. There was a multiple message from the boss. He was waiting for an important meeting, which he was to coordinate. And then lately, you know, he got the firing from the boss also. And meeting went bad, right, with the customer. Now, what has happened in this entire story? So the story is that how you manage a difficult situation. So the ability to manage situation also tells you or teaches you that whether, you know, you will create a happy environment in the organization, or whether it's a family front or the professional front.
And what, what started off in the personal life carried on till the
professional life and impacted the result. So the outcome, the desired outcome of the business meeting was to get the order from the customer. And everything has failed in the process, which has started from the personal happiness.
Yes.
So again, I would say that how you inculcate that culture and environment of managing the difficult situation or managing any situation. So learning from these kind of stories, around, I think, 15 years back when I used to work for Maruti Suzuki, I also had the similar kind of behavior. Again, we are a human being.
Yeah.
So then, you know, I started at home, because my kids were very young, I started that anything happen at home, suppose, you know, they have broken a glass or some crockery. So I started saying good luck. So my wife used to just tell me, oh, these people, they have destroyed it and they've broken the crockery and this, that, blah, blah. I said, it's a good luck because now we will buy a new one.
Yeah.
Right? So anything which has created a disturbance with you, if you look at that, what will be the new solution or new option you can get? I think that attitude will help.
So you inculcate positivity, keep on inculcating positivity in your life, and that probably is the key to happiness.
And it brings equilibrium between your personal and professional life as well.
Tell me something, you know, when you started, you know, India as a market or India as a country, the workplace has changed in the last 30 years and it has drastically changed. When you started, you know, I don't think happiness was even in the mind of any of the employers. The word was also not there, you know. They were, you know, the mindset was probably, you know, that you have come here to work, you have to work, you know. We have hired you to work. That was the mindset. But, you know, things have changed. Now, companies realized, companies have, you know, understood that it is important to keep the people happy, you know. It's a peaceful environment, you know, when you started, there would be a lot of labor union problems as well, which probably has, I think, you know, decreased with time. So how do you think, you know, in this last 30 years, this transition that you have seen, how do you think, what triggered or what brought in that change? Is it our overall growth in economy? Is it our change in society? Is it way the, you know, businesses started thinking about people or the way businesses changed? Or is it, you know, I could say that, you know, even after the COVID, companies realized that, you know, people are important and we should stay with the people. People, the perspective changed. Even as human beings or as person, our perspective changed. You know, we, from a very materialistic point of view, where we used to link happiness with, you know, achievement or, you know, some gain, we realize that health is important, we realize that, you know, our personal security is important, our job is important. You know, many people lost their jobs. So we those who had their jobs, we realize that, you know, we are lucky to have retained our jobs.
So, see, Prajal, I had some different experience when I started my career.
Yeah.
What you said was also right. But I believe that relationship orientation 30 years back was very strong.
Okay.
When I'm making this statement, just to qualify, from my first job till today, I had an extremely wonderful relation with all my immediate bosses, you know, at least, you know, immediate bosses and some of the team members, and they are still the friends. And I'm talking about, you know, 30 years back when I started my first job. Even that gentleman is still, we are good friends. Right. So the relationship orientation was very high. The personal care and touch element was also there. And that was the biggest motivating factor and engagement driver. In my second job, there was my immediate reporting manager. The gentleman must be around 80, still healthy and fine in Delhi NCR. And let me tell you, still today when I meet him, I still touch his 5 feet.
Okay.
Because he's a father figure to me. Same is the case with all of the people, even Mr. S.Y. Siddiqui in Maru. Anything happened to me, he's the first contact point for me, just to seek any guidance and advice. Whatever important decision I have to take, especially in the professional life, I consult him. Then many other people, you know. So what I am trying to say is that the engagement quotient before was driven by the relationship quotient. And that was the most, you know, and then we never looked at the money and other materialistic thing. But now the paradigm has changed. And I think this is an impact of actually the cutthroat competition, because even the businesses, they are got into the competitive environment. The economy has moved from the closed economy to a global economy. We have entered, or rather it was there. I mean, nobody tried it, but gradually, you know, we have moved in a global boundarylessness society. When we were kid, traveling abroad was a dream. Only in my thinking, in my dream, employees of external ministry would have traveled,
yeah.
Right? We have seen those days. We could never presume that we can travel, forget about international, domestic travel by aircraft. We never thought about it, right? Traveling in Rajdhani was a dream those days, AC.
But general middle class families, you know, it's...
So as the industrialization started, industrialization, urbanization, materialist thing, exposure to the global economy, global world, but actual cutthroat competition has started, and it has challenged the ways and means of doing the business. Right. Now, over a period of time, businesses were compelled to double their revenue at half the fixed cost and with 1.5 times of expected results. So it means that if a guy was doing, let's say, a job, so his deliverables were increased to 1.5 times,
and
the revenue target were made double, and the cost at the 50% of what it was, right? Now in that rat race, the rat race that has started, it's a kind of the fight of, you know, big fish and a small fish has started, that smaller fish will eat, big fish will eat the smaller fish. I think their complexities has started in because of the multiple reasons. And that has actually forced all of us in this kind of a situation what we are in today, right? And therefore, because earlier the incumbent used to desire for organization to join in. I remember I applied for DCM because DCM administration, like TASC, DCM has a model of hiring graduate engineers trainee, and there DCM was a pioneer in India to start that program, and we were so mad about it. I didn't get selected in DCM, and that was a highly demotivating factor for me. Similarly, TASC, they and DCM the graduate engineer program, in my thinking, it was as tough as civil services today, right? From there, where, you know, there was the organization what at a recipient, so the incumbent was the recipient, and the organizations were at a very higher stature in the social strata. Now the situation has changed, right? The organization are looking for the capability.
Capability.
Forget about certain things.
That's not a deciding factor,
Right, and your education, your institute, the number, the kind of marks you obtain in your school and colleges, these are the determining factor what kind of organization you will start your career with. Right, in our days, our time, 60-70% was a great achievement. We never dreamed 99 or 100% marks those days. So things have, multiple things have changed over a period of time. But this rat race, which I've seen, normally people are running behind the material. People are looking at, you know, what kind of a mobile phone they are using, or which kind of a car they drive, or what kind of a restaurant they go for dining. I think this. Everything and blind race, rather, I would say, and living a life on credit, it has, you know, totally destroyed this entire happiness quotient. And that is why organization, in order to keep engaging people and creating a talent, whether you call it talent attraction or talent management or talent development strategy, everyone is looking for this happiness and all of that kind of stuff. Earlier, we never used to talk about it because we believed that people were happy because they were satisfied or happy. In a, their needs were very small, but now people are unable to even differentiate between need and want. Right. So the focus before 30 years back was on need. Now it is want. So everyone wants everything. Right. And thanks to the mass media and all these, you know, the businesses, because they have the way the advertising company, they portray and display their product and services, whether you need it or you don't need it, you want it by hook or crook, and for that you need money. And then that is the rat race, that, okay, one job, then second job and third job and so on and so forth. And it's a big struggle, not only for the organization, but also for the people as well.
You're saying that, you know, it has become much more, you know, employee happiness has become much more structured, and it is a business need currently. That is exactly why. In earlier days, you know, it was more of interpersonal, you know, relationship that mattered. Interpersonal relations. How has that changed? You know, I know a lot of people have told me that the interpersonal relationship, what you were sharing, that, you know, you still touch the feet of your first boss, or the kind of relationship that, you know, you have with Mr. Siddiqui at, of, you know, Maruti Suzuki, and where you still go to him for, you know, professional advice on certain matters. That interpersonal skill, relationship has changed a lot, you know, these days. There is not such bonding, and probably that is why we need a strategy to keep people happy.
I think, yes, because, you know, the life is more governed by the mechanics rather than the heart. I believe the HR professional should more be oriented towards the interpersonal relationship. I personally believe that maybe if given a choice, I would like to rename HRD into HHRD.
Okay.
It's a heart-to-heart relationship development. Right. If I tell you a few examples of, let's say, Maruti Suzuki, we have started the family get-togethers. Nothing related to the business. No cost at the company. It's a personal cost.
Okay.
And so I started. In fact, I started it. Right. And after, you know, I had a discussion with Mr. Siddiqui, and we had a wonderful memories for those days. Right? When I moved to other company like Jubilant and iShare, I know the entire of my team, even in Unipath. You know, one who is my best friend in Unipath is the young daughter of one of my senior colleagues. You know, she is my best friend, right? What I'm trying to say, it again depends.
She also works at Unipath.
He is a head of HR for one of my manufacturing facility. His daughter is my best friend.
Okay.
Point which I'm saying is that I know my entire team, their family, their children, their parents. Right. I know them personally. Even, and I'm not talking about only NCR, Pan India. Everyone knows my wife. My colleagues' spouse, they know my wife and they can interact with each other, right? And that somewhere somebody has to make a beginning on that. Even today, I believe the kind of complexities we live in and the complexities which we have created for ourselves in our personal life and professional life, both somewhere this relationship orientation needs to be focused on, and especially after this experience of COVID last 15 months. None other thing will help you. People have, they were running pillar to post, they couldn't buy the hospital bed with the money they might have earned and saved, right? It's only the relationship which has brought them the medical care, the support system, right, the confidence. And many of the people who could survive or who could come back after this COVID infection, when I spoke to them, that what was their driving force, or what was the element which could give them that kind of a confidence that they will overcome it? They said only and only the relationship.
Only a
relationship.
Yeah.
Only the relationship. Talking to the people over phone had given tremendous confidence to them. And everything what we are discussing, Prajal, is talking nothing else but the happiness. So being happy, stay happy, it depends only on you. No, well, it's not a kind of a medicine which you can buy from a chemist shop and eat it.
And in what you are talking about, you know, like how you know your colleagues or your colleagues know your families, you know, and you know their families. It happens only in India. The other day also I was talking to somebody. I said it's very unique to the Indian work culture or Indian society, you know. People build relationship at work. People, you know, people don't keep their professional and their personal life separate. Probably, and that is why, because we build relationship, you know, our way we perceive happiness at work is very different, you know.
Similarly, one of my colleagues from the previous organization, his mother-in-law and father-in-law is very close to me.
Okay.
So even the relationship has gone to that extent. What I'm trying to say is that it depends your orientation, what kind of an aura you would like to create an organization. And I believe that the people in the role of a HR, whether it's a CHR or any other person, I think leadership is not limiting to only the HR function, but the senior leaders in any business, they must look at all these aspects what we have discussed. And this is important. And I think if people are happy, your business results will come automatically. So the business success largely depend on happy, healthy, and engaged workforce. And when I say workforce, That means we are not limiting ourselves only to the white collar population. It's, I'm also looking at equally to the shop floor workers.
Shop floor. Tell me something last.
And just to add on, another thought process to some of the audience who will watch this video. When you and me and all the senior professionals like us in our organization, we dream to buy a good attire for ourselves, go for fine dining, buy a new car after every 3 or 4 years. If a worker at the shop floor also have a smaller dream to maybe buying a cycle for his son, or maybe buying a small sari at the time of Diwali, and they demand bonus or they demand some incremental change in their salary, what harm they are doing? So we get worried for salary increases to the workers. We pay money to advocates or labor advisors how to save bonus, how to cut the small salary element from the worker salary. But when it comes to us, we need handsome salary increments.
So people, organizations should avoid that, you know.
I mean, we should treat people like
people.
Then there is no differentiation between white collar and blue people.
Okay. You know, one last thing. You have worked across companies, you know, across sectors. Which was one company where you were the happiest? I know it could be a difficult choice, but you know, it is like asking you to choose between, you know, who is your best child or who is your best. But obviously, you know, there are certain companies, you know, where we work, we still cherish those memories, you know, where we really felt that, you know, we're part of it. You know, there could be several reasons why you leave, you move out, you know, that is irrespective, I think. But yes, I enjoyed, or, you know, I was thoroughly happy my entire stint with that organization.
Maruti was one example, not because of my role or my accomplishment there, but again, because of the very strong relationship orientation which I was talking about. I think there, you know, the satisfaction level was very high. I decided to move out of Maruti for some different reasons. That was one. And honestly, what I'm doing in Unipart last about 2.5 years, that is, again, gives me a sense of satisfaction. And most importantly, empowerment, which we have tried to create. I won't claim that, you know, we have achieved pinnacle and we are doing wonders. But people orientation in this organization is tremendous. And that gives me a very high sense of satisfaction and happiness that, okay, whatever little I could do to the organization, I'm happy. Because I believe, which I normally talk here also, that, you know, the leaders, they should ask two questions to themselves in any organization. One question is that what kind of an organization they would like to leave for their future generations. And second question is how they would like to be remembered when they are not there. And our entire strategy, our all action plan should be driven around these two pillars, which I believe. And if you do that, if you think rationally, if you think humanistically, you will get your answers.
Great, Anil. And thank you for your time. And that was great discussion, you know, happiness with you.
You know. Same here, brother. So be happy, make people happy, right? And spread happiness.
Yes, that's our motto. Great talking to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.